tell if two individuals that look very healthy have been exposed to a particular pathogen in the past. We could try and use ELISA to detect antibodies in the blood of the individual. The technique works, or this idea works, because individuals, living systems, have an immune system that helps them protect themselves against invading other living organisms. So in the case of a virus or bacteria that enters any human body, unless the individual has an immunocompromising disease, they will defend themselves, and the output of that defense are antibodies ultimately. The technique is not just for detecting antibodies though. It can be used to detect any secondary metabolite that has an affinity with another molecule. It can be used to detect proteins, even peptides, nucleic acids, hormones, herbicides, a huge range of applications. The process for ELISAs involves you first coating the surface with a viral or bacterial component that you want to detect generally, and then you go ahead and take blood from the individual that you want to determine if they've been exposed to that particular pathogen, and then you would incubate it. In this case, if you're looking at SARS-CoV-2, you incubate the blood with the spike protein that's been coated to the surface of the 96 well plate. See if there are antibodies in the blood that recognizes the spike protein. The initial antibody antigen detection can be, the sensitivity of it as well as the specificity of it can be increased by then introducing an additional detector, so a secondary antibody, which allows you to detect the initial interaction indirectly. So it's called an indirect ELISA, and this tends to be much more sensitive and less likely to give you false positives. Where you introduce a chromogenic detection system, light absorbance of the visibly colored substrate is used to detect the interaction, and you use something called a spectral photometer. The principle here is that every compound, colored or not, absorbs light characteristically. So they have a specific way that they absorb light. And so by measuring how much light passes through the colored product produced by the enzyme in response to the underlying antigen-antibody interaction, you can analyze the sample or specimen. So you can use this principle to decide if there has been an antibody produced against an antigen, just as a yes or no. Or you can even, if you fine-tune it and put standards, so known amounts of the antigen in there against which you can read your unknown concentration, then you can even decide how much of the antibody antigen interactions are there in a sample or amongst individuals. In the scenario where you just wanted to know is the antibody interaction there, but you don't necessarily want to measure how much of it there is, then you can use a simple cutoff analysis. The simple cutoff analysis, you're going to have a positive control and a negative control on the well. And the positive control checks that the assay, the ELISA, worked as it should. The negative control that's provided in the kit, or if you prepared it yourself, is going to be used to determine the cutoff. And the cutoff is the value that will determine that an interaction has occurred. So anything that is below the negative control value, or at the same as the negative control value, will be considered that there is no interaction between your ligand and your antibody or epitope that you're interacting with. And then anything above that, a particular value will be calculated to show that anything above it, you could be like a standard deviation above the average of the negative control, or it could be two standard deviations above, or three standard deviations, or it could be a customized value that's based on the actual assay parameters or conditions that you're measuring. And so that value will be worked out, and then you have to use that to, in addition to the negative value absorbance reading, the average of it, because usually you do this in replicates so that you can determine the cutoff value for those that are to be considered as a proper interaction. you will be giving a value that will represent a cutoff value. And the cutoff value would usually be your reading of the negatives, whatever absorbance your negative where there's no antibody-antigen interaction, whatever that absorbance reading is, plus a particular amount. So you're measuring, because there's spectrophotometer, you're measuring optical densities. So it will say plus 0.4, for instance, and that's going to be your cutoff. So it's your negative read plus a value, a particular value, and anything above that is going to be considered positive. Anything below that is going to be considered negative. These scenarios, when you get your cutoff value, you actually work out a ratio. So whatever the reading was, you will divide your reading by the cutoff value, and it is the ratio of that that will tell you whether it's a yes or a no for your antibody antigen that you're trying to detect. More commonly, you may want to actually know how much of the antigen you have between samples or between individuals where you're detecting a particular antigen or antibody. And this is because sometimes the amount of something you have actually determines whether the person is sick or, you know, what the outcome is going to be for the person. So typically people, researchers or your experiments, you'd want to know how much and compare how much you have between samples. This scenario, you would need a standard curve. You would take a known amount of the antibody or antigen that you're trying to detect. You would do serial dilutions. I have a video up here on how to do serial dilution. It's a critical technique for bioscientists, for anyone working in the laboratory in biological sciences. So take a look at that. So you take a known amount, you do a serial dilution, and the serial dilution allows you to just to incrementally decide how much protein is in each well. That's going to act as something called a standard curve. A standard curve in the sense that it's going to be a reference point for all the samples which you are going to analyze from sources that you don't know how much there is. So the standard curve will be used to reference that, and you read off the standard curve, compare the standard curve with your reading from the unknown patients or samples or experimental group to see how they compare, and from that, you know, estimate how much protein or how much antibody or antigen you have in the unknown samples or specimens. In a spectrophotometer, the absorption of light through that solution, and depending on how much color there is, there'll be different absorption or optical densities as is reported. And your optical densities is then the Y variable because it's the response, and then your independent variable is the known concentration, so you put that on the x-axis, and then from that you'll be able to infer the unknown concentrations, and so you draw a line, and the equation of the line is just turns out to be y equals mx plus b. But you know, you can't use a straight line for biological responses, it turns out. It's actually a sigmoidal response in a case where there's sort of the binding is different at different concentrations, so it's not a linear scale, so that's why you can't use a straight line. When you draw the graph, you have the concentrations and then you have their responses, and so if the points are close to a straight line, that's when you can use a linear regression. That's when you can use the equation y equals mx plus b. And y equals mx plus b means the response equals or depends on m times x plus b. And m, it turns out, is the slope. So the angle of the line, it's the angle of the line times your concentration, which is x, plus your y-intercept. And your y-intercept is given the symbol b. And your it just means the intercept of the line on y, which is your response. And so it turns out that unless you're using very limited range of concentrations, you're not really going to have your responses being fitting around a straight line. They're more likely to fit on in a shape that's called a sigmoidal shape. that S shape for like a dose response. And so that S shape is analyzed in a different way, because you don't just have these two constants, the M and B, the slope and the y-intercept, being the critical factor. There are other factors, and it turns out there are four. So in the straight line, you just have two constants or two parameters that describe that slope or that y. It's actually y equals, so the y is the response. But when it's the sigmoidal shape, you actually have four constants that describe it. And so that's the 4P, or the four parameter logistics. It turns out that the four parameters you need are really just to fit the shape. So when it was linear, you only needed two. You just needed the slope and you needed the intercept of B, which is the y-intercept. So you just needed a slope and the y-intercept when it's a straight line. But when it's sigmoidal, you need to know the minimum signal, the half maximum signal, and then you just have this inflection point where it sort of turns and starts to go up to plateau. And then you also need the maximum. And so those are the four parameters. And that's why you assess these sigmoidal shaped fits with a four parameter fit, rather than this a straight line, which is just two parameters. It just captures more accurately so that you can read the unknown values. The minimum signal is the point where there isn't much of a signal. It's very close to your negative control. The maximum signal is the point where, even though you have a lot of interactions between your ligand and your antibody, or your antigen and your antibody, you just won't be able to detect any more signal. It's saturated. It's the maximum output you're going to get from the system, from the assay that you set up. Then there's your inflection point. Your inflection point is giving the alphabet B, or the symbol B. It's halfway off your slope, halfway up the slope. And it's called another name. It's called the Hill coefficient. And finally, there's the fourth parameter, which is the concentration where you get half of your maximum signal. So there's the maximum signal where it's saturated. And so halfway of that is your L50. So that's your ligand concentration, when your ligand concentration is at half of its maximal saturation. And if you are interested in joining the study group, go ahead and hit the subscribe button, and I will catch you in the next video. God bless you and take care.